all the wonderful insights that we're going to share today about love. I ask you all to join us for our opening number. I think all of us can relate to this at different times. I'm not lost, I'm just exploring.
If I could look down on this path I walk from somewhere way up high, I could see the crooked road that I have come. I've walked a mile in sorrow, I've walked a mile in joy, and now I'm less afraid of either one. For every tear I've cried, there's a smile that I have earned. For every mile I walk, there's a lesson I learn. I'm not lost, I am exploring. Life is an adventure worth enjoying. Though I may not know where I'm going, I am not lost, I am exploring.
Y'all feel free to clap if you can show more of
them. Some people who live their lives on quiet avenues, while others find a place in the parade. Some like me are seekers, we take this troubled road, believing we can find a better way. And though I get discouraged, I won't be turning back. I have joy as my compass and faith as my land. I'm not lost, I am exploring. Life is an adventure worth enjoying. Though I may not know where I'm exploring. All of us are headed for the same destination, so why not blaze a trail and find imagination? I'm not lost, I am exploring. Life is an adventure worth enjoying. Though I may not
appreciate it. Thank you, Andre, for sharing that. Because we were all welcome. We now go into our home of prayer and thinking about the lesson for today, what's love got to do with it. As looking through my material and thinking about this, I wanted to, of course, be an affirmative prayer. You know, an affirmative prayer is where we can identify and recognize and acknowledge our divine identity. And many of us in unity are familiar with the invocation prayer written by Charles Gilmore. And what I want to read this morning is the affirmative change version that Paul Hasselbeck has done. So take a big deep breath in. Blow it out. And just get in touch with that divine essence within yourself. You can think of these words. I am the presence of pure being, emanating the Holy Spirit of life, love, and wisdom. I am all that God is expressing at the point of me. As I express divine wisdom, all thoughts of mortal limitations have no power over me. I am the substance and power of pure love, bringing into manifestation my world according to divine law. And so it is. Now it's time for our meeting break, I believe. So everybody will stay. Go to your neighbor, shake hands, give a hug.
Play the game, it's easy.
Love,
there's nothing you can make that can't be made.
Love,
no one you can save that can't be saved.
Love,
there's nothing you can do, but you can learn how to be you in time. It's easy. Here we go. All you need is love. Da 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 da.
All you need is love.
Da 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 da.
All you need is love.
Love.
Love is all you need.
Mm-hmm. All you need is love. La da da da. All you need is love. La da 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 da. All you need is love. Love. Love is all you need.
Love, love, love. Love, love, love.
To the last one more time to the chorus, everybody. All you need is love.
La da 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 da.
All you need is love.
La da 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 da.
All you need is love.
Love.
Love is all you need.
All you need is love.
Okay, one more time. All you need is love.
La da 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 da.
All you need is love, love. Love is all you need.
Love is all you need. Love is all you need.
Thank you so much for helping with that. We came in strong for the important part.
We're going to come now to the lighting of the Christ candle.
The Christ candle represents the light of love and joy in God within each one of us. The spark of light that rests inside of us, that as we let it grow and burn, spreads light to our friends, to our families, to our cities, to our states, the country, and the world. Spread your light. Let it burn brightly. That's what the light is about. That's what the Christ candle represents. Thank you. Join me now in our statement of being here. I'm going to ask that when you start this statement, you say, I am. Did it not be, I am? It be, I am. So if you'll join me in saying the statement of being,
I am an individualized expression of God. I am everyone with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance.
All right, so this next song is titled is Listen for the Whisper. It is by our featured artist of the month, Janice Stanfield. Our opening song was also by Janice Stanfield. So we will be doing that one for our opening song for the rest of this month and intermixing other songs like Listen for the Whisper. I tune in to the experts on all the TV shows. I read the books that tell me all the things that I should know. I ask my friends what they think of the things I'm going through. When no one has the answer, I know what to do. I listen for the whisper deep down inside. Listen for the whisper, a strong but gentle guide, with a thousand different voices ringing in my ear. I listen for the whisper, only the heart can hear. The other voices tell me that I'm not good enough. When the peace of mind they say that I'm not worthy of. And though they shout so loudly, sometimes I can hardly think. I know where to turn to find the source of my strength. I listen for the whisper deep down inside. listen for the whisper, a strong but gentle guide, with a thousand different voices ringing in my ear. I listen for the whisper, and only the heart can hear. Well, the whisper holds the answer, it's up to me to ask. I wonder why so often the thing that I do last is listen for the whisper deep down inside. Listen for the whisper, a strong but gentle guide, with a thousand different voices ringing in my ear. I listen for the whisper, only the heart can. Listen for the whisper deep down inside. Listen for the whisper, a strong but gentle guide, with a thousand different voices ringing in my ear. I listen for the whisper, only the heart can hear.
Thank you.
And now I'd like to introduce our guest speaker for today, Beverly Pryor. She's an LUT from Unity of Dallas. And so I'd like to welcome her now to deliver her message, What's Love Got to Do with It? Try not to sing that when you think it.
Yeah. Okay, I couldn't resist this. They're sitting right here on the piano, so. Does that look good on me? Love? Does hearts look good on me? Some love? All right, I'm not gonna wear it the whole time because I think it could be distracting and I might lose credibility, I don't know, it's possible. Exactly, because I'm so cool. I can make a fool of myself and no problem. I'm so happy to be here and thank you for having me back. How many of you were here when I spoke last year? A few of you. So then I spoke about a journey that I've been on for a number of years. Oh, how do I describe it? Returning to my true self. Coming back to the truth that I am love. Coming back to the truth that you are love, that we're all love, right? And so I'd made a declaration to myself to expand my capacity to love. Now, my capacity to love was never diminished. It was my awareness of that capacity, right? Just through different life events, right? We have this way of being in the world where we learn that sometimes, you know, we have to protect ourselves from this and that, and we have to judge those and separate ourselves, and it's all to protect. But when we come into this world, we are pure love, and that's it. Have you ever looked at an infant? Have you ever looked at that face? I mean, in my family, anytime there was a baby in the room, the baby was the center, and we all just gathered around to soak it up. And you know what I realized in reflection was that in our family, we were very formal. We weren't really touchy-feely, and we didn't, you know, throw the I love you around very much. As a matter of fact, I didn't really hear it growing up. So when that baby came in the room, there it was. And I never thought about it before, but yeah, then we were all drinking in that pure essence that we all had a desire to be, to experience, to be the presence of. And we were connecting with that baby, that pure source, you know? It's so beautiful every time because they're just innocent. They came into this world knowing exactly why they're here. They're here to be love, 100% and nothing else, right? So last year, I was inspired to start some little projects, one of which, I don't know if you received one of these when you came in the door, but if you didn't, there's a whole bucket of them. And the people who have been to Dallas know that I give these out all the time. And there's a little wristband inside. On one side it says, I am love. On the other side, it just has the website that kind of tells you what our purpose is. But on the card, a lot of times people take the wristband out and they leave the card. The card folds over, and inside, it just gives you a little guidance on how to I've been meditating with these for over a year now. And so just gives you a little guidance on to activate it. You don't have to do it right now, just set it aside. But it's like to activate it, you know, it's connect in with your heart. And in a moment, we'll see a little video that'll explain to you where that came from. And then it says to keep that charge of love with your little wristband, think positive words, think positive thoughts, use positive words, do positive actions toward yourself and others. Random acts of kindness, and express gratitude. Simple, simple formula. But sometimes we forget that in our day-to-day lives, right? So the wristband's just a reminder. And so you'll see a lot of people when you come to Dallas wearing the wristband. But when I was telling people about this little project that I'm going to do this project, you know, I ordered 10,000 of them. So that's why I'm like, take as many as you want to share with, whoever you want to share with, because I'm still packaging them up and we're still giving them out. When I thought about, 1,000, yeah, I could give those out, but 10,000 seems like a better number. It just seemed like the right number. So that's what I'm doing. It's just my gift. It's just my gift and my way to help you remember, as I've been working to remember, who I am. But during the time of putting this together, someone said to me, how's your love thing any different from anybody else's love thing? And I was like, well, you know, tell me about somebody else's love thing and I'll compare and contrast for you, just like we were in, literature class. They also said, love is overused anyway. And you know, I will tell you, I'm not a person that believes that love is a word that can be overused. So let me ask you, can the word love be overused? I mean, you don't have to disagree, right? Because that's what I think. If you disagree with me, speak up. It's okay. There are a lot of people that think, oh, I love your shoes, or I love this, or, you know, love ya. Now, that's not I love. Love ya, that's kind of an offhand way to say it. But what if I say, I really love your shoes, and I'm expressing appreciation, and I'm expressing, you know, wow, I really do think that they look comfortable, and they're beautiful, and they look good on your feet, and they go with your outfit, and I'm expressing appreciation. My heart is opening up, right? I'm not closed off when I'm saying that. If I'm just saying it, it's all about the energy with which you express, right? And you don't even have to use words to express love. You can just look at someone, you know? You can share an eye contact. We used to have an AV guy at Unity of Dallas, and he was very, you know, persnickety, and he'd get himself worked up, and sometimes I'd just look at him across the room and go, like, you okay? And that little look made him feel comforted. And he told me that one time. He's like, you know, I love it when I get eye contact with you. And I know you're present, and I know you're concerned, and I know I feel your love. And I know that if I needed something right that minute, you'd be on it, and you would help me, and you'd take care of it. So love is just a word if you make it just a word, right? But if you make it a way of being, if you remember who you are and you make love who you are in the world and your mission to become more and more and more of it, regardless of circumstances, regardless of how your day begins, if you choose to be love, your life will transform without a doubt. Has anybody read this little book, The Prospering Power of Love by Catherine Ponder? So she wrote this book in the 60s. She was a minister, a Unity minister, and she wrote about, she wrote stories. Most of her books are stories, which make them very relatable. Actual people where they have intentionally affirmed, the way you did your beautiful affirmation this morning, using affirmative prayer to infuse love into situations in your personal life as well as in the business life. And the stories are really inspiring, and they're very, very sweet. I'm sorry, I'm not used to this one. So love can just be a word, right? And there's lots of definitions, and a lot of them are not universal love. They're an intense feeling of deep affection. And, someone, love of my life. You know, a lot of these terms make it connected with an emotion that I wouldn't really call love, right? It's affection, or it's admiration, or sometimes it's just purely chemical. We've all had those moments, right? I mean, that can be the case. And it can be a lot more than that. Do you love me? Caring for, deep affection, holding very in a special way. We've had those feelings, and we know that those feelings sometimes can be a little bit limiting, right? Because they're of that moment, and they can pass. And if you haven't made that choice to be love, or to remain love, or to express love, those moments pass, and then you're kind of like, oh, well, it was great yesterday, right? When I had that little momentary feeling. But we can actually choose our feelings and emotions. Do you know that? Feelings and emotions are not just a reaction to circumstances. We can actually choose how we want to be in any particular circumstance. So what love is not, you probably know this, it's not possessive. It's not controlling. I need you to be this way so I can love you, right? Did you have anybody ever had that experience with someone? Yes? If you're this way, then I love you. If you don't, or clinging, right? Oh, I need you to be with me. Otherwise, you don't tell me that you love me. I don't feel it. I can't know it. It's not limiting another person. Well, if you go off and do that, then I'll be left behind. So you can't do what you need to do because I need you to do what I need you to do. That's not love, right? We have that with our family members, sometimes our children, and sometimes our spouses, and even sometimes our friends, right? Don't go off and leave me, but I don't want to do what you're doing. So you hold back and be here with me. You sit still and be quiet, right? You diminish your light so that I can feel comfortable. That's not love, right? Trading, bargaining, or withholding. I give you my love, but oh, if you're gonna go over and sit over there, then I can't love you over there. I can't give you my love. You give me this and then I'll give you my love, right? That's not love. That's not what love is. So I was in a study group with one of my sailing clubs, and we were reading Greg Baer's material, and he talks a lot about these kinds of things. But I started looking around, I'm like, where do I see that kind of love that doesn't have these characteristics, right? And we've all heard this, how Paul has written in Corinthians about love, right? But what he's speaking of is the presence of love, right? He's saying you can make noise about I love this and I'm a loving person. You can claim a lot of things. But if you're not being it, if you're not showing up every day and expressing yourself as love, then you're just a clanging cymbal and a noisy drum. You know, you're just talking love. And I think that's where people who say, well, love is overused, they focused a little bit on that, right? But we know where we put our attention, that's what grows. So if you focus your attention on where love is not showing up exactly the way you want it, then you find more of that in the world. If you look for love in all the right places, which begins inside of you, right? We're going to look for love and be love. Then once you open your eyes, everything is love. And everyone is an expression of love. And when they're not, you can understand that maybe they're crying for love, because sometimes even behavior that doesn't come across as loving is a demand for love. What they're really looking for is someone to love them unconditionally, someone to love them in spite of their behavior, right? And these are learned things. So the Bible talks a lot about love, and a lot of it is attributed to Jesus and Jesus' teachings. That's my favorite, all of what he says about love. So in 1 John, I put it in categories of God is love and we are love and I am love. Everyone's love and everything is love because love is our very nature. Like I said, with the little baby, it's the way you come into the world. In 1 John it says, so we have come to know and to believe that love, that the love that God has for us, God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. That's in unity, we call that the Christ within. When you're connected with that truth, that you are God, you are God. You are not all that God is, but God is expressing through you, and God is the love that's in the world. That's what we call God, right? God's not a separate being. God is the love that expresses through us. Sorry, I have a little scratchy throat this morning. So your love, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, right? That's sometimes a little bit challenging, isn't it? Sometimes when we look at another, whether they're really physically our neighbor, or they live in another state, or in another part of the world, or they belong to a different belief system, or a different race, or their skin's a different color, sometimes we have conditioning that separates us in our mind, but that's just in our mind. It's not a real separation because there is no separation, right? We're all one. And that's really, once you start really focusing on being the presence of love, you experience that more and more and more. And you find that as you show up as love, like, what? How could I be love right now? What would be a loving thing to do in this moment if someone is speaking to me a certain way? How can I look at them with compassionate eyes? And how can I be love regardless of their behavior, regardless of the circumstances? Maybe I'm in a workplace situation where I'm frustrated, or I don't feel valued in a certain way that I think I should. Well, how can I show up as love, maybe to understand that other person? I've been in that situation before with my boss. And he was a certain personality type, and quite honestly, my first instinct was to just avoid him. And so when we would have a meeting, if he wouldn't show up, I'd just kind of go, whew, boy, I didn't have to deal with that today. But what I didn't do is make an effort to reschedule the meeting. And I really believe on an energetic level, he could feel that I felt relief in not interacting with him. And so he became more and more aggressive toward me. And I literally had to start thinking, what does he need? Maybe he needs reassurance that I value him. Maybe he needs to understand that I believe he has something to contribute to my day, that I actually did need and want that meeting with him. I had to change my point of view, and I couldn't just do it on a surface level, right? I had to do it from my heart. I had to do it with sincerity because he could hear. We met mostly by phone. So he could hear in my voice whether or not I valued that time with him, which is not what I was expressing by being relieved when he didn't call, you know? So over time, it wasn't like the next day, but over time, that relationship truly transformed. And I began to listen, to learn. He was very reserved and didn't share. But sometimes I would ask just enough of a question to learn a little bit more about him. And I learned that his managerial pattern was very much aligned with the way he was fathered, because that was his example. And it was extremely stern and condescending and controlling. And once I learned that, it's like, oh, this is a behavior that he has. He doesn't have another tool in his toolbox, so I could have empathy for him, right? I could understand where he was coming from, and maybe he was struggling to figure out how to manage someone independent like me. I gave him respect, but I really didn't try to understand him. And once I did that, it bridged that relationship and it healed it. So much so that even after not being my manager for a while, last year when I was laid off from that company, he reached out and said, whatever you need, whenever you need it. It doesn't matter if we're not in communication. If you need something, you let me know and I'll be there for you. So that went from we're avoiding one another to I'm here for you. But that didn't happen except that I came in alignment with myself. And then I saw him through the eyes of love, right? Love is not a romantic notion, right? As I said before, that's chemistry, that's trading, oh, she'll look good on my arm, you know, those kind of things. Those are superficial. Love is who we are. It's our very nature. So in John 13:34, Jesus said, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. But it's not just love from that superficial level, right? It's love from that energetic level. Because you can love someone, you can send them love from a distance, and they can feel it. There's so many examples in Catherine Ponder's book about how someone was having an issue and they started praying and it transformed. There was a really funny story. I don't know if I told you this, guys, before, but when my mom was in the hospital one time, there were some ladies from her Baptist church there, and they were talking about another person, another lady in the church, and how she just needed some changing, right? She needed to get her act together with whatever. I wasn't really listening to those examples because I wasn't all that interested in what they felt was wrong with her. But they decided they were going to start praying for her. They were going to pray her right. And they did. And they prayed and they prayed and they prayed. And they said to me, and they said, and then she started doing this and this and this and this. And they said, my mom wasn't really involved in the conversation. These two ladies were having it, and I was sitting over here listening-ish. And my mom was there and just listening. And they said, don't you believe in that, Beverly? You can pray, and you can just really pray, really change someone. And I said, yes, I do believe that. And what I'm curious is, do you think the prayer changed? You were the ones praying. Did it change you, or did it change her? And they kind of went, well, as if they needed to change, right? That wasn't a judgment. That was simply my question, right? Because what does change? When you pray for another person, you are putting that positive energy of love. If you pray in a way that's loving and supportive, right? If you pray focusing on their limitations and their what's wrong with them, as opposed to what the potential is for this human being, if you pray from that all infinite possibility, then you're opening your heart. You're opening your consciousness to see them in a new way in which you've not allowed yourself to see them before. Yes, it is going to change you. It's going to change them. It's going to change your dynamic. Because love does transform. Love is very, very powerful. There's a book called Power Versus Force. Have you read it? So David R. Hawkins is an MD and a PhD. So he's clinical and he's medical. So he had some spiritual experiences early on in his life. But he started learning about applied kinesiology. And so, you know, that's muscle testing for those of you who are not familiar with kinesiology. And so what he did was he said, well, we want to measure the vibration, the rating level of various emotions. So they went through a scientific process of muscle testing, and they came up with a rating scale. And I have some copies of it, and we'll look at a chart later, but I don't think you can see it. But it has a, they made a map of consciousness. And so despising and vindictive and guilt and shame and all that are like 20, 30. The vibration's very low. But when you get up to love, it's 500. So that vibration level that you're putting out into the world is much higher. And he did this, he validated it with proper testing models. So it's not just woo-woo his opinion. He didn't download it from somewhere. He went through scientific methods to establish that. But in power, in prospering power of love, Catherine Ponder talks about a study that was being conducted at Harvard back in the 60s, where they were actually measuring, let's see what page is that, 13. And she references, well, she says, first of all, she says, you do not have to search outside yourself for love. You can begin realizing it from within outward, through your thoughts, words, and et cetera, your actions and affirmative prayers. As you do, you will experience the success power of love in all its fullness as it works through people, situations, and conditions that concern you. So that's her whole point of this book, The Prospering Power. Whatever success means to you, it can all be affected by applying love from within outward. And then she talks about this sociologist at Harvard. She said their findings were that love, like other good things, can be produced deliberately by human beings. Love is not a reaction to just the right circumstances. Love can be produced deliberately by human beings. Do you believe that? Yeah? You can choose love. It's not just something that happens when somebody walks in the door and you go, oh, I've been waiting all my life. And there they come walking in the door. This is my moment. I've been waiting. And here it is. So let's play the video that kind of explains this whole point about how love is something that we can choose and create. Can we full-size that screen? Thank you.
Over the past 18 years, our research center has investigated heart-brain interactions, how the heart and the brain communicate with each other and how that affects consciousness and our perceptions. One of the things we identified in our research was the state we now call coherence. And what we found was that when we're feeling positive emotions, like we're really appreciating the sunset or really feeling love or compassion or care for someone, that the heart beats out a very different message. And the heart generates by far the largest rhythmic electromagnetic field produced in the body. And what we've now found is that if we look at the spectrum analysis of the magnetic field radiated by the heart, that emotional information is actually encoded and modulating into those fields. So by learning to shift our emotions, that's changing the information we're encoding into the magnetic fields radiated by the heart, and that can impact those around us. We are fundamentally and deeply interconnected with each other and the planet itself, and what we do individually really does count and matters.
So you're familiar, I'm sure, with Heart Math Institute and that whole process of heart-head coherence. But I love that little clip because it's only a minute and a half and it says so much. In Catherine Ponder's book from the 60s, saying the same thing, right? She says, bless your problems, whatever they be, with a thought somewhat like this. I now release you and bless you. Divine love is adjusting my life and its problems, realizing that I abide in peace. Every person who thus allies himself with the power of divine love creates a bit of heaven on earth. Could we stop that from repeating? That's actually going on to the next video, I think. A couple of things that he said in that video. When you're feeling positive emotions, like appreciating the sunset, or even feeling love or compassion for someone, the heart beats out a different message. The heart beats out a different message. Now, back in the 60s, and they were studying this at Harvard, they didn't have all these machines that measured these wavelengths, right? But now they can actually measure that wavelength that you're putting out. But we don't really need to have be hooked up to a machine, right? We can measure it by the response that we get from people. You wake up in the morning and you choose to begin your day, and I do this honestly, I'm not just saying this, I do this myself every morning before I get out of bed, I generate a state of gratitude. I just open my heart and I start there. I don't attach it to a thing or a person or a circumstance. I just start with that energy of gratitude before my feet hit the floor. And my days are blessed because of that. And if they're not on the surface blessed, I can find the blessing in it. But one other thing that he said was what we do individually really does count and matters. What we do individually. Have you ever had those days where you just felt like, how am I making a difference in the world? But you are. Every moment. And you're making a difference one direction or the other. But it's your choice. And I love this heart math work because it really is empowering us. It's showing us exactly how it is that we make that difference. So just to reiterate, these are the diagrams that were in there. Your energy field, the one on the left, it says your energy field influences those around you. This is the law of vibration. You've heard of the law of attraction, right? But the law of vibration is the overarching law of the law of attraction, right? Because it's not really attracting things in. I don't really even love that phrase. It is, if my vibration is a 20, then my vibration's connecting with someone else's vibration that's a 20. And if my vibration is love and it's 500, I'm connecting and I'm giving others the opportunity to connect with that higher vibration of love. And you see in this other diagram, I wanted to have these stills because that video went by so fast. Physically, this is what's going on all the time. Your energy, we're here, but we're also here. This is how we say we're an expression of God, because God is everywhere in all things, right? In you and you and you and you and you. So everything is God, but then in this human form, a little sliver of that manifest in me, and this much more of me all around me. So when I am love, I'm having an impact on the world. And when I'm with other people who are love, that's why the Bible says where two or more are gathered, right? This is ancient text. They didn't have these diagrams. They didn't have these machines, but they knew this truth, right? Exponentially, when we are love, you, Unity of Little Rock, as a community, when your intention is love, 111 overlap, multiply from this building out into all of Little Rock and Arkansas, United States, there's no limit to how much love you can be in this world. And this is showing you how you may have frustration and that's your irregular. That's actually what the diagram looks like. I mean, it looks like when they measure it, that's your heart wave, your heart beating. And then when you get in coherence and you line up your heart and your mind, you've got these smooth, even lines. You literally have control over this. You literally, actually do in your life. He says, failures of self-regulation are central to the vast majority of health and social problems that plague modern societies. The most important strength that the majority of people need to build is the capacity to self-regulate their emotions, attitudes, and behaviors. This is a scientist. You have this power. Now, how do you do this? How do you choose your feelings? How do you choose the emotions you put out in the world? Well, you have to every single day decide that's what you're going to be, right? Prayer and meditation. When you get still, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand if you meditate every day, because I know some of you do, and some of you might, sometimes, and some of you might not ever have. But meditation quiets you so that you're not reacting all the time, and that you can actually get into that state where you choose how you're going to be. And you might have a little moment. I still have those little moments where I'm like, especially in traffic, right? I am honestly pretty profane. Not the whole driving trip, but every once in a while somebody will do something and I'm like, and then I'm thinking afterward when I regain myself, then I send a blessing because I've sent the opposite of a blessing. And so whoever that was that cut me off, I just say, I hope you have a safe trip, and I'm grateful that there was no interaction on the physical plane in that moment where you cut off in front of me, and I bless you to make it all the way to your destination safe and happy, and that whatever interaction you have when you get there is loving and productive. And then I choose to change my, I'm still having that moment of being human, and then I flip it over and I say, this is a moment for me to bless, right? And we can do that. Take that moment when you feel that, and go, okay, I can choose to bless this moment, whatever it is. If you're upset because your child or your spouse leaves socks on the floor, you can be aggravated, or you can pick up those socks and you can choose to bless those socks. That when they put those socks on their feet, wherever they walk, they become a blessing. They're finding their center and they're able to be love in the world. That changed that sock from, they don't listen to me, to, this is an opportunity to bless. This is an opportunity for me to give love into their item that's going to soon be on their body and on their feet and touching them. In Dallas, in February, we collect stuffed animals. We call it Love Bears All. And we have them sitting all over the sanctuary. And we hug them and we infuse them with love. And then at the end of the month, we give them to police officers or other organizations where they deal with children in trauma. So those children receive that little item, and it's already got the loving vibration in it. And I know for a fact they feel it, because it's our consciousness that's putting that out in the world. And it makes a difference, just like he said. What you do individually really does count and matters. So this is a chart of the power versus force that I mentioned earlier, and it just shows you. But you see, love is 500, but look at what's 540, joy. So how often do you look for joy or have a really create joy in your life? Are you willing to create a little joy right now? Raise your hand if you're willing. Okay, raise it up high, because I want to see that everybody's willing, so we're all going to participate, right? Yes? All right, so you've already committed without knowing what I'm going to ask you to do. So, have you ever heard of laughing yoga?
Yes.
So, what you do is you start with ha, 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 right? Not ho, 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 or he, he, he. You're doing ha, ha, ha. And then you throw your head back, and you're going, ha, ha, ha. Come on. Come on. Beautiful. Now, how do you feel? Do you feel some joy in this room? Because it's kind of silly, And even the people who didn't want to participate because it's just not your thing, you still feel it, I'm sure. I'm sure you still feel the vibration that was created by doing that, right? So you can have a moment of joy anytime you want to. And if you would like to put on a movie or watch a stand-up comedian or something that gives you a reason to ha-ha-ha, you can do it. But just like love, we can create that emotion with our intention, right? We don't have to have an outside force. When I am love, I'm not waiting for something to interact with to be love. I'm priming myself to be love, and then when I have that interaction, I'm already love, right? I'm already there. So we made some joy. So let's make some peace now. Let's see, find some peace. So we're gonna just have a little moment of meditation. So if you will, take whatever's out of your hands and put your feet flat on the floor, uncross hands and feet. And if you want, just put your palms up in an open mudra on your lap. And let's all close our eyes together. And let's take a deep breath in and release. And just breathing through our nose, breathing in deeply. Just a little pause at the top of that breath and then slowly release. Now just following that breath as it moves in your nostrils, deeper and deeper to the very center of your being. You've been here before. It's where you began. This is your secret place of the Most High. This is where you know your truth, that you are love. You are peace. And you are joy. In your mind's eye, you may notice a tiny speck of light. And as you breathe in, that light grows brighter. And as you breathe out, that light expands equally in every direction, filling every cell of your body, healing and enlivening, energizing. Now allow that to move out from your body, connecting with those in this room, filling this room, filling this building, throughout the city, the state, across the United States, and all through our world, enveloping our world with your love, your peace, and your joy. Moving out from the world into the universe. The center of you is everywhere, and the circumference cannot be found. You are limitless and boundless. As we move into a moment of silence, Now slowly and gently bring your attention back to this place and this time, bringing back with you that feeling of infinite potential, the truth of your very nature. And when you're ready, you can move your fingers and toes and gently open your eyes. For this truth of the infinite nature of love, peace, and joy we all are in this world, we say thank you, thank you, thank you. And so it is.
This one? Yeah. We're just going to do this next?
Yes.
Okay.
One more song of my love.
I need to sing.
Colors and promises.
how to be brave. How can I love when I'm afraid to fall? Watching you stand alone, all of my doubt suddenly goes away somehow. One step closer. I have died every day waiting for you. Darling, don't be afraid. I have loved you for 1,000 years. I love you for 1,000 more. Time stands still, beauty in all she is. I will be brave, I will not let anything take away what's standing in front of me. Every breath, every hour has come to this. One step closer. I have died every day waiting for you. Darling, don't be afraid. I have loved you for 1,000 years. I love you for 1,000 more. All along I believed I would find you. Time has brought your heart to me, and I have loved you for 1,000 years. I love you for 1,000 more. Died every day waiting for you. Darling, don't be afraid. I have loved you for 1,000 years. I love you for 1,000 more. All along I believed I would find you. Time has brought your heart to me, and I have loved you for 1,000 years. I love you for 1,000
more. Come to the part of our service where you have the opportunity to give. And I always remind you that as you give, so you shall receive, multiplied, pressed down, and increased in good measure. We do our best to use everything we receive here to better our community, to better our church. So please, give with love.
Must understand, touch of your hand,
thunder,
we'll just sing the chorus.
Okay.
physical.
What's love got to do with it? What's love but a second-hand emotion? What's love got to do with it? Who needs a heart when a heart can be broken?
We're done now. We had to. I'm sorry.
Sorry. But thanks for trying.
Amanda, can I have the next slide, please?
Oh, yeah.
He forgot that was your...
If you'll join me. Divine joy as me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you.
And now it's time for hats and glasses and special Unity uniforms.
Throw me a pair.
Andre, I have some headbands here if you'd like to come up here. And
oh, I get to join you today?
If you'd like to. I'd love to have you up here with me.
You just want me to wear the headbands.
Let me.
Oh, there's more.
Yay!
Wait, there's more.
Who would like to wear these?
Andre wants a pair.
Well, I might as well go all the way.
Right.
You know.
Whoa!
the Unity of Little Rock announcements uniform.
And the good news is that tomorrow starts the Human Together Choir, their spring session. And I know Tam was involved in that last time. Is there anything else you wanted to add about that?
Just that they're going to meet here this next session, which doesn't really make a difference, but it will be here, so you'll know where to find it. It's a lot of fun. You don't really have to be a great singer or even really sing much at all to join and have fun, because there's enough voices there that if you really scare yourself when you sing, it'd be fine, because there's enough people there to drown you out. So it's great fun. I would absolutely recommend it if you could do it on Monday night, and it'll meet for 12 of the next 13 weeks. I think there's a week off in March, but come out and have fun.
Thanks. And then on Wednesday, the Songwriters Group is going to be here. I know Bill's not here today. He's in St. Louis celebrating his son's birthday, but he will be back for the Songwriters Group on Wednesday. Sounds of Unity is this Friday, which is always a great musical.
If you haven't been to a Sounds of Unity Friday, you have really, really missed out.
Yes.
So this is something to put on your calendar. There's posters in the back, little 8.5 by 11 posters, so you can put one on your refrigerator so you don't forget, or you can take some and put them on public bulletin boards so that more people will find out about Sounds of Unity and join us.
Great. Oh, and Saturday is WOW. And once again, I'm asking for the guys to come and join us, because we're going to be making lunch for our house. I have a sign-up sheet here. We've decided our menu is going to be a taco bar. And so I have a sign-up sheet here. If you would come see me afterwards, we can make the stuff here. Unlike Ronald McDonald House, we are allowed to make it here in this kitchen. And then we're going to carpool over there at about 11:15, 11:30. But we also need help bagging up all of our community exchange items that people have brought in. If you're not well aware of that, we have food items, we have men's clothes, we have women's clothes, we have baby clothes, we have, you name it, we have it back there. Shoes. We have awesome shoes. And Sandy has a great idea that we're going to do a fashion show afterwards, so people can show off all the stuff that they have gotten at the community exchange. But we're going to bag it up, and we're going to donate it all to our house. for the people in need over there. So I could really use everyone's help with that. We also have some planning to do, and I'm sure Pamela would love for some more help with that. Kathy Hardy announced that she finished one already, so I said, right? Huge. I said, make sure you tell Pam, and I know what she's gonna say. Great, start another one. So, right, Pam? Never too late to do that. So we have planning we can do. We also have a bag of yarn that was donated by one of Cherry's neighbors. It's never too late to start making hats for the kids at Arkansas Children's Hospital for next year. So there's lots to do on Saturday. So I would appreciate everybody and anybody that can come to help out with this great community outreach endeavor. Want to talk about the member orientation?
We're having a new member orientation. So if you've been coming and you want to officially become a member, we will have a new member orientation February 18th at 9:45 a.m. And Russ looks like he has something to say about that.
That is 9 a.m., not 9:45, because Russ has a lot to say, just saying.
He also gets up really early, you know.
We'll show you where the secret rooms are.
And then there'll be a C class. Beverly will be coming back to join us in March, March 10th and 11th.
9th, 10th, and 11th.
So
3-day weekend. Got to get 10 hours in there. So that's see Friday, Beverly Saturday, about that. And another announcement is March 18th is going to be our town hall meeting. You need to go online to renew your membership. This is something that is in the Unity bylaws, and here's a great caveat to that. If you sign up and come on March 18th, gives you the right to vote to get rid of that bylaw so we don't have to do it every year. So there are forms here that you can do it on hard copy or go online. So, but that's the great thing that we can come and we can actually vote to stop doing this. I remember it was a big hassle. I remember this back in Michigan, everyone would like, you know who I am. But you have to do it right now. It's part of our bylaw. So if you want voting privileges, you need to go back on and renew your membership. You can do it online. You can do it here. And then come on the 18th, stay after service for the meeting, and vote to get rid of it.
Right. Yes.
Right. Yes.
And we will be, that's our annual meeting. We will be covering a lot of material. That's when we discuss our financial condition, our plans for the church for the next year. So if you want to have input, come to the meeting. If you want to have real input, be a member. If you want to be a member, do what was just suggested. Go online or go to take a form in the back and fill it out. And hopefully we can eliminate that repetitive annual fees by a vote. So thank you all. Anything
else?
That's it.
Circle up.
Circle up.
If everyone could get as close to a circle as we could, we might have to go down the aisle, hoedown style.
It's more of an oval.
Yes. One of these days, we'll just like start playing like a square dance or something and throw everyone off.
Swing your partner around and around.
Or do an angel walk.
Yeah. What's that?
An angel watch, you go down the middle and everybody whispers loving angel things in your ears.
Oh, Beverly just had the coolest idea ever, everybody. She said there's something called an angel wash where people walk down and then
with eyes closed, you walk down the middle. Wow.
And people whisper really loving things to you. We should try this sometime.
Try it.
We'd be here like another 5 hours or so. But, all right. Hey, Russ, do you want to do this? Because you normally do this. This because there used to be parts in yellow and now there's not.
There's not. We're doing it all.
Are you serious? Okay, then I can do this. Okay.
I'll just get confused about which part's yours. It's all yours.
All right. Okay, then I will read as it is written.
Just read all together.
All right. So, the light of God surrounds us. I am the light. The love of God enfolds us. I am the love. The power of God protects us. I am the power. The presence of God watches over us. I am the presence. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. I need to change the PowerPoint. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as our Creator, family all are we. Let us walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my joyous vow. To take each moment and live each moment.